Praise the Lord, I'm glad you're here.
Welcome to Woodward Avenue Baptist Church. My name is Timmy Ray, and I am excited you're here today. We are a church family committed to reaching people on the shoals and beyond with the gospel of Jesus Christ and equipping them to become fully devoted disciples. If you are looking for a church home in the Shoals area, I hope you will prayerfully consider Woodward Avenue Baptist Church. Let's take a moment to look at some of our upcoming activities.
Awana Clubs begin this evening at 5:30 p.m. Sparks and TNT Clubbers will check in at the Welcome Center counter, and Cubbies and Puggles will check in at the Children's Check-In Desk. We are looking forward to watching your children grow in their knowledge of the Bible this year.
Our monthly business meeting will be Wednesday, August 23rd at 6:40 p.m. in the Adult Education Building.
The deacons will meet tonight at 7 p.m. in the Adult Education Building.
This month's XYZ Group Fellowship and Luncheon will be Thursday, August 24th at 10:30 a.m. in the Adult Education Building. All are welcome to join this group.
Children's Choir will begin this Wednesday evening, August 16th at 6 o'clock in the Children's Building. They will begin working on their Christmas program, The Colors of Christmas. We hope that you will allow and encourage your children to be part of this year's Christmas musical.
The benevolence team is in need of a dryer. If you have one available, please contact the church office.
The Worship Choir Christmas Musical Kickoff will be Wednesday, August 30th at 6 p.m. in the Activities Building. If you are not part of the choir but would like to join us for the Christmas program, please come. We would love to have you be a part of this event. We'll have a Christmas party and read through the musical in its entirety, so it's a great time to join the choir if you've been thinking about it.
This year's annual church picnic will be held September 24th and will feature an outdoor worship and baptismal service in the parking lot next to the Activities Building. There will be no Sunday school on this day. I've encouraged you to invite your one to this event. Please be in prayer concerning how God wants to use your sphere of influence to reach people for the gospel. The service will begin at 10:30 a.m. with a covered dish luncheon to follow.
For more information about our church ministries or upcoming events, download our church app to your smartphone and tablet, or visit our website at www.woodwardavenuebaptist.org. There you will find links to our various social media sites. We hope you will take the time to connect with us. If you would like a copy of today's service, you may call our church office at 256-383-4078. Thank you for worshiping with us today.
Good morning. I'm so glad you've chosen to worship with us. Let's stand and sing together.
Master and my God, assist me to proclaim. Well, it is good to see all of you here this morning. This morning is a special Sunday because we get to take part in a commissioning service for five of our folks who are going to be heading to New York, technically Brooklyn, this week to be a part of helping a church plant, part of our association. I want to read to you a passage of scripture where we find the church at Antioch first commissioning what I would probably argue is some of the first missionaries. We find the church gathering together. And it tells us in chapter 13 of the book of Acts that while they were worshiping, they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said to them, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." Then after fasting and praying, they laid their hands on them and they sent them off. This morning we have an opportunity to do that as our association will be leading a group to go again to Brooklyn, New York. So let me just give you the names of those who are participating in the trip, and then I'll mention those who will be a part of from our church participating. First, some of the names you'll recognize. Barrett Long will be going, Jim Leonard, Jerry Clemens, Earl Moore, Kathy McCarthy, and led by Dr. Eddie Garter, who's with us this morning. And then from our church, we have Phil Richardson, Jerry Plaxco, Melinda Neal, and Mike and Allison Brooks. And so as we participate in this commissioning service, we want to send them off with our church's blessing. Let me say thank you on their behalf for supporting them and encouraging them as you participated in the fundraiser to help pay their way. And now we want to give them not just with our finances, we want to support them with our prayers. So if you're one of those five, I want to invite you to come down to the altar. So Jerry and Phil and Melinda, Mike and Allison, if you would make your way down to the altar. And then I'm going to ask if some of our men, maybe some of our deacons or some of our ladies, if you want to come and just lay your hands on them, we're going to be praying for them at this time. All right, let's pray together. Holy God, we thank you so much for the opportunity to gather together as a family of faith. Lord, we thank you for what you're doing in the life of our church as we recognize the call that you've given all of us to proclaim the gospel in the Shoals and beyond. And Lord, I thank you for those who have surrendered to be a part of this week's trip. Lord, I pray that as they go, that you would be with them, that you would keep them safe, provide a hedge of protection around them. Lord, as they go to help a church plant in Brooklyn, Lord, I pray that you would bless that church. And I pray, Lord, that this would be a productive week where they would get an opportunity to share the gospel. They would get an opportunity to build up and strengthen a local church there in Brooklyn. And Lord, I thank you for the ways that you are using our association of churches to make a difference around the globe. And so, Lord, I pray that you would be with each one who's participating, even those who are not here this morning. Lord, we lift them up to you. We pray for their safety. We pray for their protection. But most of all, Lord, we pray that they would be used by you. And Lord, I pray that as they return back to their respective churches, particularly as our group returns back to Woodward Avenue, Lord, I pray that they would return bringing a fire within them, a fire for missions, a fire for revival. Lord, that we would be a church that is committed to the proclamation of the gospel around the globe. We pray this in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. And I hope as you see them as we have our time of welcome, and I hope as you see them as we dismiss a little bit later on, that you will let them know that you'll be praying for them. They'll be leaving this Saturday and spend a week up in New York helping a church plant there in Brooklyn and doing the work that the Lord's called them to do. Well, if you're visiting with us this morning, I want to take a moment to welcome you. If this is your first time visiting with us, or maybe you've been visiting with us for a while now, I want to say welcome. I'm glad you're here. And we have in our bulletin a little tear-off portion. We ask that you would maybe tear that off and give us a little bit of information. We'd like to know who you are, get to know you a little bit better. You can get that back to us by either placing it in the offering plate as it goes by a little bit later on in the service. Or at the end of the service, I'm going to be standing back at the Welcome Center. If you would just come and hand that to me, introduce yourself, let me get to know you a little bit better. I'd be honored if you would do that. We also, on the back of that, have a place where you can put in prayer requests. So if there's something that you've been praying about that you would like us to join with you in praying about, our staff gathers together every Tuesday. We go over all of these prayer requests, and we join with you in prayer, praying for each and every request that you put in. You can do that here. You could also do it through our church app. Put in a prayer request under the More tab on the church app. So we want to join with you in prayers. Let's take a moment now to maybe welcome one another. Let's all stand up, find somebody that maybe you haven't talked to yet this morning, and let them know that you're glad they're here.
You're a good, good father.
You are perfect in all.
Please remain standing for our offertory prayer.
The inside of your bulletin, you're going to see this week's missionary moment is for the Banks, who had an amazing journey going through Romania to end up in Nashville working with international students. So as you go through this week, be sure you pray for them. Make sure you read it. And keep praying for not only our North American missionaries, but our international missionaries. Would you pray with me? Father God, thank you. Thank you for sending your son to die on the cross for our sins and for raising him from the dead and for giving us a hope that is tied up in Jesus' resurrection, that for all who have confessed with their mouths Jesus is Lord and believe that he was raised from the dead, you will save. We have that promise in Romans chapter 10. We just affirm that. Father, thank you for the blessing that worship is, for the miracle that worship is, that all across our country right now there are people worshiping to Fannie Crosby and Chris Tomlin and listening to their pastors preach sermons and getting to do so in an environment where they don't have to face threats of death or fear. The blessing of having your word, of being able to read it anytime we want, of having open access to it, and the blessing that is to get to give to support the work of your kingdom. Father, let us not yield in our freedom what our brothers and sisters in Christ refuse to yield in their persecution, that we esteem the gospel of being highest priority. Let us not shy away from telling our friends and our neighbors and our coworkers and our loved ones about Jesus, because it's only by his name that we will be saved. Father, thank you for the cross and for the resurrection. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. seek you.
Thank you, Rachel and Leah, for leading us and reminding us about the intimacy that Christ desires of us and that we should reciprocate. At this time, we'll dismiss our children onto Children's Church. While they're making their way out, let me just take a moment to put in a little bit of a commercial here. As you can see, the kids that are making their way out, we've got a bunch of them now And we need some help with children's church. So if you would be willing, you don't have to teach or anything. Makita does all the teaching. But we need folks who can just kind of help be there, be present with the kids. So if you, we're working on a rotation. If you're available to help with our children's church, maybe just one Sunday a month. I really would like to see it be one Sunday every 8 weeks. So every 2 months, if you could do that, let me know or let McKenna know, and we'll get you on a rotation. It means you only get to have to miss the sermon one time, maybe every 2 months. Now, for you, that may be your 1 month of getting a good 30-minute nap. But, you know, I hope that we've got enough folks here that we can get enough folks to do that. So if you are available, let me know. I want to invite you this morning, if you have your Bible, to turn to the book of Ezekiel. We are continuing our series that we began last week entitled My Sphere. We're talking about the sphere of influence that God has given us. And as we read from Corinthians last week, we're asking God to expand our sphere of influence. Do you remember the homework I gave you last week? Some of you look like a deer caught in headlights. I told you to be thinking about your one, to the one person that God has placed in your sphere of influence to share the gospel with, the one person that God has put in your path to tell them about Christ, to invite them to church. And in particular, we talked about our special event that's taking place in September, where we're going to have an outdoor worship and baptismal service. We're going to have it right over here in the parking lot for our church picnic. That's September the 24th. You'll find a notice about it. It's on our Facebook page, on our website. You can see it in the bulletin, on our announcements and everything. I want you to be thinking about how God wants to leverage your sphere of influence for the sake of the gospel. That was Paul's prayer. Paul says, Lord, you've called me to the Gentiles. You particularly have called me to the church at Corinth, and I pray that you would continue to expand my influence so that others may hear the truth of the gospel. That's what we're talking about this morning as we look at the book of Ezekiel. Ezekiel is one of those Old Testament prophets that fits within the Babylonian crisis. So if you're not familiar with your Old Testament history, let me kind of rewind a little bit and give you a little bit of background so that you understand Ezekiel a little bit better. You will remember that the Israelites were enslaved in Egypt, and God used Moses to get them out of Egypt. Well, when Moses led the people out of Egypt, Moses climbed up Mount Sinai there in the Sinai Peninsula, and God and Moses had a conversation where God said, hey, Moses, I want the people of Israel to be my special people. I want to bless them. I want to use them, and I want them to honor me. And so we have what we call the Sinai Covenant, where God's people, Israel, and God, they come together and they agree to a relationship, a special relationship. That Sinai Covenant is a conditional covenant where God said, if you obey, then I will bless. And so when we think about, well, what is the if? What are the things they're supposed to obey? Well, think about the Ten Commandments, the beginnings of the book of the law, where God said, this is what I expect you to do. You know, have no other gods before me. Have no idols. Don't use the Lord's name in vain. Honor the Sabbath. Honor your father and mother. Don't kill. Don't commit adultery. Don't steal. Don't lie. Don't covet. He gives us those commandments, and he says, this is what I expect you to do. And so skipping through a lot of great history, what we find is Israel wasn't really great at doing that. They weren't really great at honoring God. And so they reject God, and they ask for a king, and then they reject God again, and that kingdom splits, and then they reject God again, and one of the nations gets destroyed, and then that they reject God again, and the nation of Judah then finds themselves in a crisis. The nation of Babylon is coming in to attack Judah. The nation of Babylon is coming in and threatening Judah, threatening to carry them off into exile. And as a matter of fact, they do. They end up ultimately taking Israel, taking the nation of Judah captive because the nation of Judah had failed to honor God. Well, Ezekiel was called by God to be a prophet during this time. Ezekiel's told by God, I want you to go to the people of Judah, and I want you to warn them that if they don't honor me, then I'm no longer going to bless them. If they don't honor me, I'm no longer going to protect them, and I'm going to let the nation of Babylon come in and do whatever it wants to do. Their protection, or my protection, is no longer going to be on them. And so Ezekiel does just that. Ezekiel goes to the people and he says, if you don't repent, if you don't follow God, if you don't honor the covenant, then God is going to remove his blessing and enemies are going to come and attack and we're going to get taken off into exile. Ezekiel said, if we're not careful, God is going to allow the nation to come and destroy Jerusalem. Babylon is going to carry us all, and we're going to be in trouble. And so from chapters 1 through chapter 24, Ezekiel says, be careful, Israel, or else God's going to allow this judgment to come upon you. And then from chapter 25 through chapter 32, Ezekiel talks about not just the judgment for Israel, but the judgment for all the nations. And then beginning in verse 33, we begin to see a picture of hope. And there is this transitional chapter where Ezekiel comes in and he says, this is what I've tried to warn you about. This is what I've tried to warn you about. You see, in verse 21 of chapter 33, a person comes to Babylon from Jerusalem. A lot of the people had already been carried off. A lot of the people have already been exiled into Babylon. But someone from Jerusalem comes to Babylon and says, Jerusalem's been destroyed. Jerusalem's been wiped out. And you can imagine all of those who grew up in Jerusalem, now living in Babylon, they're devastated. Because their hometown, their home city has been destroyed. Even worse, it represents God's very home. Jerusalem was a place where God lived. The temple was. And he says, it's all gone. It's all wiped out. And Ezekiel says, I tried to tell you this is what was going to happen. We pick up the story in Ezekiel chapter 33. We're going to begin by reading just the first 9 verses of Ezekiel 33. It says, the word of the Lord came to me, son of man, speak to your people and say to them, if I bring the sword upon a land, and if the people of the land take a man from among them and make him their watchman, and if he sees the sword coming upon the land and blows the trumpet and warns the people, then if anyone who hears the sound of the trumpet does not take warning, and the sword comes and takes him away, his blood shall be on his own head. He heard the sound of the trumpet and did not take warning. His blood shall be upon himself. But if he had taken warning, he would have saved his life. But if the watchman sees the sword coming and does not blow the trumpet, so that the people are not warned, and the sword comes and takes any one of them, that person is taken away in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at the watchman's hand. So you, son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. And whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. And if I say to the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from his ways, that wicked person shall die in his iniquity. But his blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from his way, and he does not turn from his way, that person shall die in his iniquity, but you will have delivered your soul. Ezekiel comes in, and Ezekiel is essentially giving the role of the prophet here. Ezekiel is saying, God's speaking to Ezekiel, and God is saying, Ezekiel, this is what I've called you to do. You are my watchman. He says, this is the role of the Old Testament prophet. This is your role, Ezekiel. Your job is to be the watchman. Now, why did they need a watchman? What was the reason for the watchman? Well, the Lord gives us that. He says in the first few verses here, he says, if I bring the sword against a nation and the people are a watchman, and the sword comes from the land, he's to blow the trumpet. He's to sound the warning. You see, what would happen in the ancient Near East is they didn't have radar. They didn't have satellites. The ways that armies would attack each other is they would try to attack a city by surprise. Because if you could get them when they weren't expecting you, you had a greater military advantage over no warning. To win a battle. And so some of the most important people in the military there in the ancient Near East were the watchmen. These were the people that were appointed to sit in their tower and to look out for the enemy army coming. They were armed with a horn. They were armed with a trumpet to blow, the shofar. They were responsible for whenever they would see the enemy coming, they were responsible for blowing the horn so that the army could get ready to defend itself from the oncoming battle. And so the Lord is speaking here, and he's saying there is a reason to have a watchman. The watchman's job is to sound the trumpet for warning. The watchman's job is to say, there is an enemy coming, and there is danger ahead. And he tells Ezekiel, he says, that's the role of the prophet. The role of the prophet is to be the watchman, because they have a responsibility to warn the people. You see the reason for the watchman, an enemy's coming, but then you see the responsibility of the watchman. He says in verse 6, he says, but if the watchman sees the sword coming and does not blow the trumpet so that the people are not warned, the sword comes and takes one of them away. That person is taken away in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at the watchman's hand. You see, what God is saying through Ezekiel, he's saying, Ezekiel, you are the prophet. It is your job, it is your responsibility to see the warning and to sound the warning. You see, God spoke to Ezekiel and he said, be careful. The people of Israel need to be careful because I am coming. Now we could say, well, he's talking about Babylon here, and yes, he's talking about Babylon, but essentially the Lord is saying, I am sending my judgment on the people. They've rejected me. We had a covenant at Mount Sinai. They've rejected this covenant over and over and over and over again. And so, Ezekiel, I'm telling you to go and warn the people. And God says, that's your job. That's your role as a prophet, to go and to warn the people. And if you do your job right, if you sound the trumpet, if you warn the people, if you tell them that the enemy is coming to attack, then you are free and clear from any responsibility. But if you don't blow the horn, he says, if the watchman sees the sword coming, if he knows the enemy's on his way, but he doesn't blow the trumpet, and the people aren't warned, and they don't know that the enemy's coming to attack, he says, the sword will come and it'll take one of them away, and that person will be taken away because of their own sin, their own judgment. God is saying that the watchman is not responsible for that person's sin, but he's saying, if you don't sound the warning, it's as if you killed them yourself. You are an accomplice to their death. And so the first 9 verses here, God is saying to Ezekiel, it is your responsibility. It is your responsibility to proclaim the warning to the people so that they will know that there is a judgment coming. And so what's happened now, for 32 chapters, Ezekiel has done just that. I mean, notice what it says in verse 7. He says, so you, son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them a warning from me. So for 32 chapters, Ezekiel has done that. God has spoken to Ezekiel. Ezekiel has given that word to the people. The question is, what are the people going to do with the warning? What are the people going to do with the warning that the Lord has given the prophet? And so in verses 1 through 9, we see the role of the prophet, but we move into verses 10 through 20, and what we find is the response of the people. We see the people give their response. Let's just pick up in verse 10. In verse 10, he says, and you, son of man, say to the house of Israel, thus have you said, surely our transgressions and our sins are upon us, and we rot away because of them. How then can we live? Say to them, as I live, declares the Lord, I have no pleasure in the depth of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn back from your evil ways. For why will you die, O house of Israel? And you, son of man, say to your people, the righteousness of the righteous shall not deliver him when he transgresses. And as for the wickedness of the wicked, he shall not fall by it, he shall not fall by it when he turns from his wickedness, and the righteous shall not be able to live by his righteousness when he sins. Though I say to the righteous, he shall surely live, yet if he trusts in the righteousness, or if he trusts in his righteousness and does injustice, none of his righteous deeds shall be remembered. But in his injustice that he has done, he shall die. Again, verse 14, he says, again, though I say to the wicked, you shall surely die, yet if he turns from his sins and does what is just and right, if the wicked restores the pledge, gives back what was taken by robbery, walks in the statutes of life, not by doing injustice, he shall surely live. He shall not die. None of the sins he has committed shall be remembered against him. He has done what is just and right. He shall surely live. Yet your people say, the way of the Lord is not just. When it is their own way that is not just. When the righteous turns from his righteousness and does injustice, he shall die for it. And when the wicked turns from his wickedness and does what is just and right, he shall live by them. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is not just. The house of Israel, I will judge each of you according to his ways. Here's what's happening. Ezekiel has proclaimed his message, and the people are responding. And what we find are the people are responding in different ways. There are some who are responding by saying, well, we've always been righteous. We've always done the right thing. We're God's people, and so we don't have to worry about this. As a matter of fact, you'll read later on, they say, we're the sons of Abraham, and so we're good. We're covered. We've got good old grandfather Abraham's taking care of us. We don't have to worry about this. There were those who would say, well, we know we're sinners. We know we've messed up, and we need God's forgiveness. We need God's mercy, and so there's those who were repentant. And then there were those who just didn't listen. Those who just didn't care. They would listen to Ezekiel preach, and they enjoyed listening to him preach, but they would ignore his message. They wouldn't respond. And so what we find in this text is a picture to me of the proclamation of the gospel. As a matter of fact, I think Paul had this in mind when he goes to different places like Ephesus and he says, I've proclaimed the gospel to you. Your blood is on your hands, not on mine. He says that to the Jews. So Paul understood this Ezekiel context, though it has an Old Testament context, Paul understood it to have a gospel-centered context as well. And what Paul is saying is, we have a responsibility for the gospel. We become the prophet to the nations. We become the prophet to our neighbors. We become the person who's called. We become the watchman. As a matter of fact, Jesus uses the word be watchful all the time. He talks about being watchful. He tells his disciples, you're to be watchful. He tells his followers, be watchful. He's saying to us, we are the watchmen for the world. It is our job to proclaim this message that there is a judgment that is coming and that there is a way to be saved. We're to blow the horn. The question we're left with is, how will people respond to our message? If we go and we share the good news, how will people respond? Or if you're here this morning and you're hearing this good news, the question you might ask is, how should you respond? Well, I think this morning as we think about the response of the people, there are three people described here. I've referenced them to you, but I want to give you names for these three people. The first person is what I would call the memorial saint. This is the person who says, well, you know, I'm really not that bad of a person. I've not sinned all that much. And you remember way back years ago when I was 8 years old at Vacation Bible School, I walked down that aisle and I said a prayer, and therefore I'm good. They've been living like a child of hell for the past 20 years, but they made that decision and they said, I'm good, I'm covered. I've got old grandfather Abraham who was a deacon, and I'm good because of that covenant that's been passed down. This is the memorial saint, and you'll notice I put the word saint in quotation marks because this is a person who has a false sense of security because of something that they did as a child, but it's not changed their life. Notice what Ezekiel calls this person. He says there in verse 13, he says, though I say to the righteous, he shall surely live, yet if he trusts in his righteousness and does injustice, none of his righteous deeds shall be remembered. But in his injustice he shall that he has done, he shall die. So essentially what Ezekiel is saying is, there are those who are saying, well, I've been righteous in the past. I made a decision one time a long, long time ago, and now I'm covered, I'm good, I don't have anything to worry about. What Ezekiel is saying is that person will surely die because they've never really had a change of heart. Their life has not been changed. Their lifestyle is a lifestyle of disobedience to God. That's what Ezekiel is saying. He's saying there are those memorial saints, those who say, I'm good, I've got it covered, because way down, long time ago, I walked down the aisle of a church. I may not ever go to church anymore. I may live like a child of hell, but it doesn't matter because a long time ago, I made that decision. And you know, we believe once saved, always saved. That's who Ezekiel's describing. He's saying there are those who have this false sense of security. They're basing their salvation on their own decision, their own righteousness. And he says that person is doomed, is doomed. They shall surely die. The New Testament would tell us that person will spend an eternity separated from God. Jesus said it this way, there are many who will say, Lord, Lord, but they will not enter the kingdom. The first response is the response of the person who's not living for Christ, not walking with Christ, but is falling back on some decision that they did a long time ago, or some relative that was a member of the church a long time ago, and that there's no sense of security. They're not walking with Christ. It's the memorial saint. Then there's the second person in verse 14. In verse 14, Ezekiel says this. He says, again, though I say to the wicked, you shall surely die, yet if he turns from his sin and does what is just and right, essentially what he's saying, he goes on, he says, okay, there are those who are wretched sinners, those who are horrible sinners, and they know they're sinners. They know they need forgiveness. They know they need to repent. Ezekiel says, though they be wretched sinners, though they have so much sin in their life, they can't even imagine being free from that sin. Ezekiel says, the grace of God is big enough and sufficient enough to offer forgiveness for that person if they are genuinely repentant. He says it is better to be the wretched sinner and seek repentance than to be the memorial saint who says, no, a long time ago I made that decision. He says, this is the person whose heart is right, whose heart repents. He says that person needs to restore their lives back. They need to give their life over to God and seek forgiveness. He says there's a memorial saint. That's one response. He says there's a repentant sinner. That's another response. And then he gives us a third category. Let's jump down to the end of the chapter in verse 30. In verse 30, he talks about Ezekiel, and what you find in verses 21 through 29 are people who are giving all of these different excuses. They're like, well, we're the children of Abraham, so God's not going to punish us. We're good. We don't have to worry about it. It's more of that picture of the memorial saint. They think we've got nothing to worry about. And then in verse 30, he describes a third category of response. In verse 30, he says, as for you, son of man, your people who talk together about you and by the walls and at the doors of the houses say to one another, each to his brother, come and hear what the word is that comes from the Lord. And they come to you as people come, and they sit before you as my people, and they hear what you say, but they will not do it. For with lustful talk in their mouths they act, their heart is set on their gain, and behold, you are to them like one who sings lustful songs with a beautiful voice and plays well on an instrument, for they hear what you say, but they will not do it. When this comes, talking about the judgment, when this comes, and come it will, then they will know that a prophet has been among them. Ezekiel says there's a third category of those who respond. He says it's those who like to listen. Those who like having their ears tickled. They go to Ezekiel and they listen to his words. They gather together and they say, well, let's go hear what the Lord has to say. Let's go gather around Ezekiel. And they listen to him like they listen to a concert. He says it's like someone with a beautiful voice that's singing a song. Everybody wants to come and be a spectator. They are the indifferent spectator because they listen, they hear, but they do nothing. They hear what's going to happen. They hear the judgment that's coming, but they do not respond. They live a life of indifference. And Ezekiel says, one day they're going to find out what judgment really is. One day they're going to realize that a prophet was among them. One day they're going to know that the Lord has spoken through his prophet. What does this all mean? I mean, for Ezekiel, what Ezekiel is saying is, Ezekiel's saying, look, this was my job to proclaim God's judgment. This was my job to tell the nation that God is coming to judge them. And I've done my job. I've proclaimed it. The response is up to the people. Ezekiel can say, I've done that. Well, as we fast forward to this text, to a New Testament context, we really see that both of these fit our situation today. First of all, we are all called to respond to the good news of Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us in the New Testament that every one of us are wretched sinners. Romans chapter 6, verse 23, the wages of sin is death. Every single one of us, you and me, all of us are sinners. All of us have fallen short of God's perfect standard. All of us fall short of God's perfect presence. And every person on the face of the earth since Adam has fallen short of God's perfect presence. We're all sinners. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, and so we deserve that wrath. We deserve God's punishment. And Ezekiel would say to the people of Israel, God's punishment is coming. The New Testament tells us God's punishment is coming. The wages of sin is death. And so every single one of us, we know we're a sinner. Every single one of us know that the wages of our sin is death. We deserve to be separated from God. The question is what are we going to do with that news? Maybe you're here this morning and you don't know what to do with that news. Well, I've got good news for you, because the people in Ezekiel's day had that same question. Look at verse 10 of chapter 33. Verse 10, they say, surely our transgressions and our sins are upon us, and we will rot away because of them. How can we live? That may be your question this morning. I know I'm a sinner. How can I live? How do I get over this sinfulness? Ezekiel says this, as I live, declares the Lord, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn back from your evil ways, for why will you die? Ezekiel pleads to the people, why would you die when you've got a God that loves you? Why would you die when you've got a God that's willing to forgive? And Romans would say the same thing, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. If Paul were here today, the author of Romans, he would say, why would you die when you could live? We're all called to respond to the gospel. Every single one of us. And I believe this morning we have the same options that Ezekiel's listeners had. We're hearing the gospel message. We have the same responsibility or the same opportunities to respond. The first response, you may be sitting here this morning, you'd be saying, nah, I'm good. I'd made a decision a really long time ago, but you know, I'm not walking with God. I don't follow God. I'm just here to have my ears tickled. But I got my great grandfather. He was a deacon. My father was a deacon. I'm good. You may be that memorial saint where you're trusting in a false sense of security. I plead you. I urge you. Come to Christ and receive genuine forgiveness. Have your life changed. You may be here this morning, and you may be the repentant sinner. You may be the one who says, I can't live. How can I live? How can God forgive me? And the good news is that the Lord, or the word tells us that the Lord forgives us. He died for our sins. He paid the price for our sin. He suffered the punishment for us. All you've got to do is believe in Christ. Confess that you're a sinner. Ask Jesus to forgive you of your sin. And you can be saved. You may be here this morning, and you may be that indifferent spectator. You may be here every Sunday, and you just may be an indifferent spectator, where you're just here to listen, to watch somebody talk, to listen to people sing. You've heard it over and over and over again. Maybe you've heard it from your friends. Maybe you've heard it from your family members. You've heard it over and over and over and over again, and you just sit there, and you continue to be indifferent. My job as your pastor is to warn you. My job as your pastor is to tell you that without Jesus Christ, there is an eternity that is coming to you, where you will not spend eternity with Christ. You will spend eternity in hell. And we don't preach about that very often, but that's the reality of Scripture. So this morning, we have a message to respond to. We have a message to respond to. How will you respond? Will you say to Christ, I need you, I need forgiveness? Maybe that's how you need to respond. Or will you just continue to live in your own indifference? Or will you continue to live on some decision that you made a long time ago that's never affected your life? It's one thing if you were 8 years old and you made that decision and Christ has penetrated your life and you've been walking with him. But if you made that decision because somebody convinced you to do that, or you walked down that aisle and your life has never changed, come and experience the real power of a God that changes your life. We all have to respond. But we're also all called to be the prophet. If you know Jesus Christ this morning, and as I look across this room, I know majority of you know Christ. You've tasted that forgiveness of sin. You've had your life changed. You are called to be the prophet. You are called to go and to share the good news. Matthew chapter 28, Jesus, in his last words to the disciples, said, go make disciples of the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all that I've commanded. And his last words in the book of Acts, recorded in the book of Acts, what does he say? He says, be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So you are called, every single one of you who claim the name of Jesus Christ, you are called to be a watchman. You're called to go to your friends, your relatives, your associates, your neighbors. You're called to tell them the good news. Jesus has commanded you to do that. And I wonder why sometimes when we think about the command of Christ, why is it that most statistics tell us that the average Christian, the average follower of Jesus Christ, never shares the gospel in their lifetime? I mean, Jesus commanded it to us. And so many of us are just comfortable sitting in our pews, gathering together in our Bible studies, but never actually making disciples. I mean, if I go to my kids and I tell them, clean your room, you know what I expect them to do? I expect them to clean their room. I don't expect them to gather together a sibling group and say, well, let's talk about what a clean room would look like. I don't expect them to gather around and discuss it and maybe spend time praying about it and say, oh, Lord, help me to clean my room. Help me to do this. I expect the room to get cleaned because I'm the dad and I'm commanding my children to do a task. That's what I expect. But somehow we've got this idea in the church that if we just gather around and if we just talk about it, but we never actually make disciples, that somehow we're honoring God. And the reality is that we are called to make disciples. We're called to do the task of being the watchman. Many of you know the name Charles Spurgeon. There was in the 1800s, he actually preached this sermon December 9th, 1860. He preached a sermon called The Wailing of Risca. There was a coal accident where many people were killed, and he was preaching a sermon in the context of this, and he's talking about this text. He's talking about being a watchman, and listen to the words of Spurgeon. He's telling the church, the people that are alive, he says, but so live that when you hear the funeral knell, for a neighbor even. In other words, when you hear the funeral bells ringing, when you know that someone has died, that you may be able to say about that person, poor soul, whether he has gone to heaven or to hell, I know I am clear of his blood. He continues, he says, oh, brothers and sisters in Christ, if sinners will be damned, at least let them leap to hell over our bodies. If they will perish, let them perish with our arms about their knees, imploring them to stay and not madly to destroy themselves. If hell must be filled, at least let it be filled in the teeth of our exertions. And let not one go there unwarned and unprayed for. When we talk about our sphere of influence, we have a responsibility to be a watchman. We have a responsibility to tell others and to warn others that without Jesus Christ, there is no forgiveness of sin. And we're called to do it in the shoal. We're called to do it in Alabama. Let me ask you again. Muscle Shoals or Florence, I'm not asking you to save the whole world, but I'm asking you if you would allow God to use you for one. That you would invite your one to be a part of our services in September, but that you don't even have to wait till September. Would you invite your one? Would you share the gospel with your one? That's my prayer. As we think about our sphere of influence, who's the one that God's placed on your heart, that God wants to use you to change their eternal destination? Who's your one? You may be here this morning and your one is you. Maybe you've never trusted Jesus Christ. Maybe the first person before you can be a sphere of influence to others, you may need to make a decision to follow Jesus Christ. Maybe you're that one. You may be here this morning and you've never made a public profession of faith. You've never trusted Jesus Christ. You may be here and you've done that, but you've never followed through in believer's baptism. And you've got all kinds of excuses as to why you've never done that. But this morning is a morning where we put aside excuses and we say, we're going to be obedient to what God's called us to do. So in just a moment, Timmy's going to come up. Our praise team's going to come up. We're going to sing a song and I'm going to be standing right down here. Ask the one. Your heart. I want you to pray for them. To come to the altar. Make up. I want to talk to you. Down here. Father, thank you for your word. And Father, I pray that we would understand the seriousness of there is an eternity from God. You've called us to proclaim that warning. And it may not be popular. It may not be cool. We may get looked at or picked on. But Lord, that's the calling you've given each and every one of us. And so, Lord, I pray this morning that you would remind us of that calling. And remind us of the consequences if we refuse to blow the trumpet. Remind us of the consequences if we continue to remain silent. Lord, this morning, for those of us in this room, Lord, I pray that we would be thinking about that one person. That one person that you've put in our path. That one person that you want to use us to reach with the gospel of Christ. May today be the day where we make that decision. We're going to be obedient. And Lord, for those that one person is them, there's someone. Here that doesn't know Christ, someone here that's never been baptized, never made that decision, may today be the day where they say, I'm ready to be baptized, I'm ready to follow Christ, I want my life to be different. Lord, I pray that we would be open to the prompting of your Spirit. Lord, as we sing in just a moment, our hearts are open. Would you speak what is true to us? We ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. As I said before, I'm going to be standing down front. If there's a decision that you need to make, if you've never trusted Christ as Savior, if you need to be baptized, if you just want to come and pray for your one, my prayer is that you would respond for your good and for God's glory as the Lord speaks to us. Let's stand and sing together.
Sure, you are alive, you've endured.
do hope you've been blessed as we have worshiped and studied God's Word together. And I know that there are still many of you who maybe it's just the crowd, maybe there's a decision you need to make, and you just were a little bit intimidated by walking forward. I want you to know that, again, I'll be standing in the back. Just come see me one-on-one. Let's talk. Let's make sure that you've made that decision, that you've got that right decision with the Lord. Before we dismiss, I do want to mention a couple of announcements, though. First is tonight is a big night because we start our Awana Clubs back. So I want to invite all of our kids to be a part, fifth grade and below. Our Awana Clubs start at 5:30. If you are in the Cubbies or the Puggles, you'll check in at the Kids Zone desk. And if you are a TNT or a Sparks, you'll check in at the Welcome Center. Excited about Awana Club starting back, so I want to encourage all of our kids to be a part of that. And then, of course, our regular worship service will start at 6. So drop the kids off, come into the sanctuary, spend some time in prayer. We'll kick off at 6 o'clock. Looking for a great night tonight. If you're part of the mission trip from our church, make sure you see me before you leave because I have something to give you, and it's something you're going to want. So come find me before you leave, and I'll get that to you. And I appreciate Dr. Eddie Gardner leading us, being part of us, our church today, being a part of our commissioning service today. So be sure to let him know you appreciate his leadership with our association. Timmy, will you dismiss us? And just wait just a moment. I almost forgot. We've got somebody that's come and said, I want to join our church. And so James Gottney has come, and he's really been praying about this for a while. I'm going to ask if there is someone who would come and stand with him in just a moment. You just come stand right alongside of him. And if y'all, as you make your way out, would you come and just greet him, say you're glad to have him as he comes by statement to join our church. Now, Timmy, will you dismiss us?
Absolutely. We're going to close this morning by singing the chorus of Good, Good Father. And you may have noticed that we're singing some new songs this morning. 2 weeks ago, we had new music night and learned 9 new songs that our congregation will be singing going forward. If you weren't with us that night, we have devotions for each of the songs on the table across from the Welcome Center. So I invite you to pick up one of those if you haven't already and kind of read over them and understand why we're singing what we're singing. And then also, if you can find a playlist on Spotify under our WABC worship account if you need to be better acquainted with the songs. So let's close now by singing Good, Good Father.
You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Thank you so much. You're dismissed.
For more information about our church or upcoming events, visit our website at www.woodwardavenuebaptist.org. We also hope you'll connect with us via our various social media pages. If you would like to request a copy of today's service, you can do so by calling 256-383-4078.
Between